Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our session on Manomin teachings. My name is Andrea Bradford, and I'm a faculty member in the School of Engineering at the University of Guelph, where I teach stream and wetland restoration, among other things, along with my colleagues, Brittany Luby, who's from the Department of History and who will be speaking in a moment, and Samantha Meltreder, a PhD student from engineering, who is also here today. I'm a member of the Manomin Project. This project is being undertaken in Treaty Number 3 territory in what is now known as Northwestern Ontario. I want to begin by acknowledging the land on which we are gathered today. I come to you from near the University of Guelph. The University of Guelph resides on the ancestral lands of the Attawandaran people and the treaty lands and territory of the Mississaugas of the Credit. Of course, today we may be gathering online from many different places, from within and outside of Canada, or outside of what is currently known as Canada. I hope that the audience members within Canada today will take time to learn more about the Indigenous territories that they're joining us from. If you want to learn more about where you're located, you can use the link nativeland.ca that I've posted in the chat to help identify the Indigenous nations that sustain you. I also encourage you to follow up by reading the text of your associated treaty to learn more about your responsibilities to Indigenous nations and the land. I've provided an additional link to Crown Indigenous Relations and Northern Affairs Canada in the chat to help you guide you, to help guide you on your learning journey. But remember that federal documents only tell one side of treaty history, and I encourage you to contact your local treaty commission or representative body to learn more about First Nations understandings of nation within nation agreements. Nation with nation agreements. We have much to learn from and with our Indigenous neighbors as we strive to steward and sustain the environment in which we live and work for all people and other than humans, present and future. We offer our respect to the members of the Anishinaabe Nation who helped to make today's sessions possible. And we endeavor to strengthen our, as we endeavor to strengthen our relationships and our knowledge. So with that, I would like to introduce Brittany Luby and ask Brittany to join us. And maybe Brittany, you could say a few words about yourself while I bring up your presentation.
Hi, everyone. My name's Brittany Luby. I'm a proud member of the Manomin Project. I was born and raised in Treaty Number 3 territory. And the community I'm going to talk to you about today is the community of my paternal ancestors, Nisechuan Anishinaabe Nation. And I gotta say, this project has just been an absolute pleasure to work on to help me grow as an Anishinaabe woman and as a treaty woman. And I'm so grateful you're all here with us today to talk about Manomin, which you may know as wild rice. If you're unfamiliar with this crop or the processing and harvesting practice, I've included a link to a video that's hosted by the National Film Board of Canada in the chat, so you can tune into that later if you'd like to learn more. So you may see my eyes glance downwards from time to time. That's because I'm going to be reading from a script to help me keep on time and to make sure that we have time to answer your questions about wetlands and Manomin before we go today. So, let's begin. In the oral tradition of the Anishinaabe, there exists a prophecy that the people would follow a sign moving inland to avoid the long boats of the European invaders and by so doing survive as a sovereign nation. When the seven prophets came to the Anishinaabe, they were living somewhere along the Atlantic coastline. According to cultural educator Edward Benton Benet, quote, there was ample food from the land and sea, and there were fish from many rivers. This fullness of life made many people doubt the predictions. Many people did not want to move their families, end quote. And yet the first prophet insisted that the Anishinaabe would find their true home where food grows on the water. The third prophet similarly predicted that the Anishinaabe would find their chosen ground in the west where food grows on the water. This food is Manomin. The survival and location of the Anishinaabe Nation is thus associated with Manomin. As Edward Benton Benet makes clear, quote, wild rice has always been regarded by the Anishinaabe as the sacred gift of their chosen ground, end quote. Manomin has helped generations of Anishinaabe to survive. by helping children to grow physically and culturally strong. Today, I'd like to talk to you about Manomin as a teacher. My partners, Andrea and Sam, will answer your questions about species and wetlands after we have this cultural teaching time. So when our ancestors brought children to harvest, they worked with Manomin, plant as teacher, to instill relational and seven generations thinking. As Soto Elder Mosam Dani explained, childhood was and is, quote, a time to begin to learn the disciplines of the community in anticipation of becoming a full contributing member, end quote. When you leave today, it's my hope that you remember Anishinaabe children learn how to relate to past, present, and future generations through Manomin, and that Anishinaabe children learned and learn they can contribute to the well-being of others, both human and other than human, through the fields. If we could pop over to the next slide, I want to make clear that I did not come to this understanding alone. Andrea, I'm still seeing the same slide there. The next image is going to show you some pictures of the elders that we work with. And I think it's important for you to see some of these elders because the knowledge I share today has been shaped not only by my personal experience, but by oral testimony from Nisshechuan Anishinaabe Nation. Eight knowledge keepers gifted me with testimony about their growing up experiences in the Manomin fields. The eldest knowledge keeper was born in 1943, and the youngest knowledge keeper was born in 1963. While knowledge keepers experienced the fields in the mid-20th century, they emphasized cultural continuity. They did not separate traditional harvesting techniques in the mid-1900s from harvesting techniques protected by Papalm Treaty in the 1800s, from harvesting techniques that predated European incursions in the 1600s. Instead, knowledge keepers saw their harvesting activities as an activation of ancestral knowledges and lifeways as part of a uniquely Anishinaabe continuum. If we could please pop over to the next slide, I'd like to take you into the Manomin fields with me. So families most often transition from berry picking to Manomin harvesting camps under elder guidance. The names of the Anishinaabe moons, which overlap very roughly with months in the Gregorian calendar, include information about our seasonal rounds. June translates roughly as strawberry moon, July translates roughly as raspberry moon, and August as ricing moon. As an independent spirit being, Manomin ripens in its own time. Anishinaabe scholar Linda LaGrard Grover explained, quote, the beginning of the harvest is determined by elders and other experienced ricers, end quote, who are watching for signs from Manomin that it is willing to yield up the gift of life. Elders would wait until the stalks were of a certain color and size, indicating that Manomin was ready to yield itself up for our well-being. And you can see here in this image that the seed head is starting to turn that dark brown. We refer to it as sun kiss, and that's one of those signs that that Manomin is ready to come in. So if we could pop over to the next slide, I want to talk to you a little bit about how labor is organized in the fields. So after knowledge keepers open the harvesting season, families travel to the field and work collaboratively to set up camp. Sleeping quarters would be laid out, but families also needed to set up areas for other vital activities. An area to parch Manomin would be established, as would an area to dance on Manomin, to separate the husk from those tasty edible bits. A rough area to train Anishinaabe youth how to harvest may be established, as would an area to rest after a hard day's work. Once a shelter was set up, in addition to working spaces, able-bodied adults would begin the laborious process of harvesting Manomin. In order to work on the water, bodily strength and coordination was and is required. Muscle is needed to maneuver the canoe through shallow waters, more frequently with a push pole than a paddle. Muscle is also needed to repeatedly pull down the stalk, hold it and knock it into your canoe. Now, children also could contribute to the Manomin harvest, but they were more likely to work from shore as they developed the bodily strength and coordination required to engage in that muscle-heavy process on the water. So adolescents would be assigned caretaking responsibility for children who are left at the campsite or on nearby islands while their guardians labored. Although children did not actively knock the plant, loosening the seed from the stalk, guardians emphasized they had a vital role to play. Jobs were scaled according to one's ability so that even the youngest children could make a contribution. At Nisechuan Anishinaabe Nation, children were taught that their play had value. It kept bears and other scavengers away from drying or stored manomin. And child's play was assigned value. Noisy games by scaring away scavengers could help secure the harvest. Children were also encouraged to alert their guardians to the potential arrival of human poachers. They were to announce any human visitors who may attempt to steal manomin brought in and being stored by their families. Knowledge keeper Clarence Henry remembered, quote, "There's always a lazy person that wants to steal a little bit of rice here and there. So the kids are supposed to keep an eye on the wild rice that the parents pick," end quote. Knowledge keeper Teresa Jourdain associated positive emotions with the job she was provided as a child, stating, quote, "You know, it was really good. We're there to watch the rice for poachers," end quote. Watching Manomin reinforced the Anishinaabe teaching that no one is too small to be part of the community, meaning everyone can contribute and by extension, find a place to belong in Anishinaabe Ake. Children were taught that their job guarding Manomin would influence familial well-being during winter months. As Lagarde Grover explained, quote, "In the old days, stored dry, it, so Manomin, was intended to last until the next year's harvest," end quote. Children thus ensured that their family was well-stocked for winter through play coded as labor. So if we could switch over to the next slide, I'd like to talk to you about how other child contributions were given meaning, cultural meaning, cultural value. So children were taught not only that their contributions were valuable, but that they had unique contributions to offer to their families and their communities as a result of their life stage. While able-bodied adults were primarily responsible for bringing in the manomin, parching and winnowing manomin, children were encouraged to dance on it, separating the husk from the rice. Children at Nisechuan Anishinaabe Nation were even provided with their own tools to complete this job. Knowledge keeper Danny Strong remembers receiving his own moccasins to dance on the rice. Quote, "They were moose hide or deer hide, and then they'd make you a pair of moccasins. Then that was mostly the kids' job, to dance on the rice in the moccasins," end quote. Children were taught to think of their smaller bodies, their lighter weights, as a gift to help with preparing manomin. Knowledge keeper Danny Strong explained further, quote, "If we get somebody like an adult, they'd just be breaking the rice. If you dance on it too hard, you won't have that rice," end quote. By assigning jobs according to nature, so children's tendency to play, and stature, so those lighter body weights, children were taught to work according to their ability. More than that, they were taught that each life stage had a unique gift to offer. Now, I'd like to switch over to the next slide, and I want to talk about the unique role children had in helping to reseed the fields. So children played an important role in reseeding the river and in securing future harvests. Under guidance, they would collect earth and pack seed into mud balls. They would then throw these mud balls into the river receding from along the shoreline. While children worked from shore, their guardians ensured mud balls were distributed by canoe. Strong explains, quote, "Some of them would go back around, throwing rice back into where we picked it," end quote. Now, this job helped to teach children about their dependence on other species. It helped to instill that relational thinking that's so essential. It's such an important cornerstone of Anishinaabe philosophies. Children quickly learned that the seed they planted may not grow without the support of other than human beings. So you learn about interspecies dependencies through the Manomin fields. Anishinaabe scholar Kathy Avery Canoe noted that hawk stands were often erected in Manomin fields. Now, hawk stands provide resting spaces for predatory species. And in return for this resting space, hawk would keep blackbird and muskrat populations low. Hawk thus helped to guard food supplies for the Anishinaabe in return for this resting space. Hawk also helped us to keep competitors out of the fields. I want to talk to you about another really important interspecies relationship that's going to help ensure Manomin can grow after we plant it. So knowledge keepers at Nisechuan Anishinaabe Nation describe the soil in Manomin fields as loon bottom. Now, much like hawk, loon with whom we share the fields helps Manomin to grow. Elder Terry Green explained that loon waste functioned as a sort of fertilizer. So by learning how to identify and care for these helper species in the field, Anishinaabe youth learn that they belong to an interdependent web of being. So hawks rely on humans to build stands, but humans rely on hawk to help guard the fields. Loon nests are established in fields maintained by the Anishinaabe, who lay tobacco to ensure its growth and its return. And in reciprocity, right, loon fertilizes the fields. By teaching Anishinaabe children about their interconnectedness, about their role in a much larger ecosystem, Anishinaabe youth develop a sense of belonging. You learn that you're never alone. And, you know, in return, right, for these contributions, the sustenance coming from your other than human relations, you also learn that you're responsible for providing for the well-being of others, both human and non-human. And I really love this quote by Anishinaabe poet and scholar Christy Leora Gansworth. She said, quote, "From scale to feather and branch, intertwined powers work together each day, constantly renewing this life that you belong to. As you exist, so do they. There is no separation," end quote. So I'd like to move over to our last slide for the presentation before we engage in the Q&A. Reciprocity and interspecies relationships provide Anishinaabe youth with a sense of community that extends beyond the human realm. But participation in the Manomin harvest also reinforces seven generations thinking. Seed selection and planting teach and affirm our connections to the future, but also to the past. After a successful harvest, Anishinaabe guardians would divvy up food for home consumption, barter or sale, and reseeding. Knowledge keeper Danny Strong indicated that about a third of the harvested Manomin would be returned to the river. Now, children were not involved in determining how Manomin was divided and distributed, but they were actively involved in that replanting. And lessons about seeding reinforced lessons about ancestral love. Children were taught to plant like their ancestors planted. They were taught that the Manomin fields they frequented were similarly planted and maintained to ensure their well-being in present times. And in this way, fields became evidence of ceremony and prayer, tobacco offerings and feasting, evidence that, quote, "those who came before you put their memories into this earth and thought of you as they made delicate steps and preparations," end quote. In this way, participating in the Manomin harvest taught Anishinaabe youth how to be good citizens of Anishinaabe Ake and of Turtle Island. It taught children how to contribute and how to form reciprocal relationships with human and other than human beings, how to contribute to your family, and how to contribute to the great web of being. More than that, working in Manomin fields taught children that they were wanted in the world, that the ancestors prepared for them. Manomin harvesting thus taught children how they belonged to the nation and that they had a duty to ensure its survival. So thank you so much for being part of this cultural teaching. If we go over to the last slide, there's some information here you may want to copy down. You can email us at manominproject@gmail.com. You can follow us at Manomin Project on Instagram or Twitter. You can also search for the Manomin page on the Niche website, where we post blogs about what we're thinking and what we're learning as we go along. And now I'd like to open up the floor and learn your questions for Manomin or your thoughts and feelings. So please jump in and join the conversation with us. And Andrea, thank you so much for your help managing the slides. That was fantastic.
I'll stop sharing in just a minute, but I'll give people a chance to write down those links just in case. And I don't see a question yet, but I'm gonna keep an eye on the questions and I'll try to direct them to either Brittany or Samantha, depending on who seems most appropriate. But I don't know, Brittany, if you wanna share anything else while we're just waiting for people to think that their questions and open that up.
I might be naughty and toss the ball over to Sam. Sam, while we're waiting for questions, do you maybe want to share, you wrote that beautiful blog post about Manomin. Do you maybe want to share some of the growing cycle?
Sure. I can do a little bit of that while we wait for some questions. So Manomin is an annual plant. So it's an annual macrophyte, which means that it grows, it's a plant that we can see, and it grows in either the shallow waters of lakes or the slower moving river waters. And when it, because it's an annual plant, it means that it's regrowing from seed each year. And so actually around this time of year, so kind of March into April, as the snow and the ice is melting, once there are several days in a row that the weather's a bit warmer and above freezing, then the seed that was that goes into the sediment from the previous season will start to germinate. And then once it starts to germinate, we go through a few different life stages. So the first life stage is submerged leaf stage. And so Manomin starts to grow and go through the sediment, so the loon bottom that Brittany was talking about. And then it continues to grow, and it's using that energy from the seed originally. When the water is nice and clear, there's good clarity, and if the water's not too deep, the plant starts to get some sunlight and can start producing its own energy through photosynthesis. The plant will then continue to grow, and then when Manomin reaches the surface, it creates these quite beautiful long ribbon-like leaves, and I haven't had the privilege of seeing it myself yet in person, but I hope to this summer. But the pictures are quite beautiful, but they're these big, long ribbon-like leaves. And what that allows the plant to do is it's even more leaf surface area for more photosynthesis, more energy production, so that it continues its growing process. So that typically happens in around July. And then kind of towards the end of July, beginning of August, we go into, the plant starts to go into aerial shoots stage. And then that's when it starts to go through the kind of the reproductive portion of its life cycle. So the plant actually has both male and female parts. They do reproduce it, or they do progress at different times, so that the plant isn't self-pollinating. But then eventually, once it's been pollinated, the head of the plant, which we saw in Brittany's slides, start to form the seeds and the grain, so the Manomin grain. And then kind of around end of August, beginning of September, Manomin should be about ready for harvest. And at that point, if untouched by humans and even while touched by humans, the seeds themselves, which are quite heavy and aerodynamic, will fall into the sediment. And then that allows for the whole process to go again for the following season. So I see we do have a question, and perhaps this one's best for Brittany, but I can read it out loud for us. This is from John and Elizabeth. Wonderful presentation. Is there a children's picture book which could be used to teach this story to non-native children at school?
I've just pitched one to Groundwood, which is an indie publisher in Canada, and I'm not sure if I'm going to have any uptake yet, but trying to think about that relational thinking piece. If you want to start small and use, you know, teach children about how we can learn from plants and animals, how they're our first teachers, there's a book called The Four Hills of Life, which kind of acknowledges that teaching. I also recently put out This Is How I Know. This is a bilingual book in English and Anishinaabe Mullen. And it asks, you know, how do I know spring is here? And then it gives you some signs from the plant and animal world. So that idea of plants and animals as teacher, Four Hills of Life, This Is How I Know. For more adult readers, Robin Kimmerer's Braiding Sweetgrass, I think is really beautifully written and can provide sort of an entry point to this thought world. So if you wanted to digest this and then maybe find a way to break it down for the younger folk in your life, that I would recommend. Sam, is there anything in your reading that comes to mind?
So I agree. I haven't gone too much into the young and the children literature out there, but in terms of kind of more adult literature, adult works, there's a piece by Venom that is kind of the first book, the big book that was around and talking about Manomin, and it does a beautiful job of explaining both the kind of the botany and the science of the plant, kind of from that Western science view, but then also goes into the cultural importance of Manomin to the Ojibwe or the Anishinaabe, and also how it's processed and how it's traditionally harvested and whatnot. So the book itself, sorry, I've got it on my shelf. I think it's called Wild Rice and the Ojibwe People, and it's by Venom. And I think it was written in the 80s, 1988, I believe.
Mm-hmm. Sam, while you were talking, two other picture books came to mind. So one is We Are Water Protectors. The illustrator is Michaela Goad. And I know that that's not directly related to Manomin, but water is life, right? And if you want to start teaching about wetlands, I think that would be a really great entry point. There's another book authored by Richard Van Camp, and I believe it's May We Always Have Enough to Share. And again, not directly about Manomin fields, but a really great entry point into thinking about redistribution, kind of contributing to the greater web of being and some of those other cultural teachings. So I think those two books are not direct links to Manomin, but entry points to some of the teachings that we can pick up in Manomin fields.
And keep an eye open for Brittany's book in the future, because I'm confident that will come to pass. Samantha, I think maybe the next question would be a good one for you to take. The question is about what areas are being restored, and maybe Sam can just take the opportunity to tell everyone a little bit about her PhD research, which is about the restoration of the Manomin fields.
Yeah, so the Manomin project, and this is kind of the first big project that we have going forward, is working with Nisechuan and Anishinaabe Nation to better understand the Manomin growth on the Upper Winnipeg River. So that's in what's currently known as Northwestern Ontario in Treaty Number 3 territory. And so Nisechuan and Anishinaabe Nation historically relied very heavily on Manomin growth, and you know, it used to grow prolifically on the Upper Winnipeg River, but currently with development and settlers coming into the area, the system, the river itself has changed quite dramatically since the early 1900s, late 1800s. One of the big things that's happened along the river is the installation of several dams. And this is quite, this really affects Manomin because Manomin, as I was kind of discussing a little bit with the life cycle, is very dependent on water levels. And when we operate dams, we're trying to control the water levels. So the natural water level patterns that would typically occur aren't happening anymore. And so then that's part of, that's potentially part of the reason that we've seen actually quite a dramatic decline in Manomin, and Nisechuan and Anishinaabe Nation has spoken to us and kind of expressed that concern and that loss of Manomin on the Upper Winnipeg River. And so my research is working with them to understand what has happened over the last 100, 150 years to kind of cause this decline. And there may be other factors at play, including industrial pollution and kind of more complexities there. And so that's what we're investigating. But then the hope is to really collaborate with the community to interpret the results that we gain, and then ultimately to come up with some potential river sharing strategies or crop restoration strategies that are suitable and culturally sensitive to Nisechuan and Anishinaabe Nation and is co-created with them, as they are an integral member of our team. So yeah, that's kind of where we're starting. We also have a side project that we're working towards because the Upper Winnipeg River is such, Winnipeg River is a very large system. Contrary to what most people think, it doesn't actually go through Winnipeg, Manitoba, but it is up towards that direction. But it does drain a very large watershed. So the river itself is quite large. And as I mentioned, it's controlled by several hydroelectric dams. So that being said, if we don't manage to find a strategy that works for Nisechuan and Anishinaabe Nation and to restore Manomin in a good way, we're also investigating some off-river sites nearby, so small lakes that might be suitable for Manomin. So hopefully that gives you an idea of at least one place that we're looking to restore Manomin growth. There are several different projects going on kind of around that area that are researching Manomin. Restoration strategies are a little bit, or restoration projects are a little bit harder to come by. But in further upstream in the watershed, the Winnipeg River drainage basin, there have been some efforts on Rainy Lake to restore Manomin growth there as well.
So Samantha, we might come back to you, but I wonder, somebody, Brittany, was interested to know how they could contribute to the project. So maybe you might wanna to jump in with a few thoughts on that.
Oh gosh, yeah. I think that it would depend where you're located and what your skills are and what your capacity is in terms of time and energy. So if you're interested in getting involved, if you could please send us an email to the manominproject@gmail.com, kind of answering some of those questions, what your interests are, what your skills level are, what you feel like you would be best be able to contribute, then we can bring that to Chief and Council for a discussion and kind of map out collaboratively what might be a great way to get involved. Immediate things that you could do that would be super helpful for us is helping to get the word out there about Manomin. So we're on Twitter and we're on Instagram at Manomin Project. So if any of the information that we're sharing there speaks to you, please pass it on and just be part of growing the conversation. And, you know, I think, and Sam and Andrea, I don't know what your thoughts are here. I think that there's a lot of misinformation, I'm going to say, out there about Manomin. And a big part of that has to do with the English name, right? Wild rice, when there's absolutely nothing wild about it. This is a crop that is cared for through ceremony. It's a crop that's actively replanted through seed selection and strategic planting. Different rivers have different tastes. So the Manomin you eat tastes like the river you harvested it from. And part of it has to do with what Sam was saying about, you know, that seed being super aerodynamic. It also, the husk is barbed to really help it kind of dig deep into the soil. And so you kind of have these regional tastes because of the way the seed is distributed. But again, nothing wild about it. So I think the more that we can get people to understand that this is, you know, a keystone crop, and just incredibly important to cultural practice, I think we'll be in a good position to start having really meaningful conversations about the importance of crop restoration, and hopefully, you know, more meaningful conversations about how to ensure all river users can share that river in a better way. So that we're not just running, you know, hydroelectric dams, for example, for industry, or solely, you know, maintaining water levels for cottagers, but we're thinking about sort of the needs of many river users to ensure that this keystone crop can continue to feed Anishinaabe. Sam and Andrea, what do you think?
Well, I guess I would say feed the, like, in a nutritional sense, and the spirit as well. So that's what I've really learned a lot more about the cultural significance of the plant. And I think that's something that we can share more broadly as well. There's lots, this has been a very exciting interdisciplinary project where all of us have a chance to learn about something we really knew very little about before. And I think we're really making kind of exciting strides, and we're you know, quite open to having dialogues with others that have different views as well, so that we can, you know, continue to build and accomplish something that's more than what any of us could do independently. Mm-hmm. Samantha?
I guess one other plug I might add, and this kind of piggybacks off of what Andrea was saying, and that we're a very interdisciplinary team, and many of us have had to kind of tread into waters that are very foreign to us, we'll say. So one of the things for myself anyways, coming from an engineering background, I've never really spent a lot of time thinking about different worldviews or, you know, the ethics of doing research with other than humans. In fact, I think very early in the project, Brittany used the term other than humans. And I was like, this seems like a weird word to use. I don't really get this. And so I've really come to understand the importance of language and the words that we choose. And we actually have a blog post about that on our website. Another piece that we recently produced more for the academic community, but it has reasonably accessible language that many could probably enjoy the piece, but was published in Water, and we investigate the importance of considering aquatic plants and the ethical treatment of aquatic plants in research, and specifically the ethics of research with human beings, and explaining that because the Anishinaabe view Manomin as a spirited being and are value that relationship so much, that if we're doing research out on the water with Manomin, then we need to be asking for consent and being culturally sensitive to our practices in a way that's very different to a traditional Western science or engineering research project. So that paper was recently published in Water, and it's called Beyond Institutional Ethics. So you might take a look at that if you're interested.
I popped it in the chat.
And I guess as more of the, you know, on the engineering side, and my background is more in water management and river sharing and considering flows on rivers. One of the things that we're doing is trying to work with some of the agencies that are responsible for river sharing and managing flows, and trying to communicate what the Manomin requires. So I guess I'm hopeful that to some extent, if we're able to communicate what the plant's needs are, that we would look for opportunities that don't necessarily take away anybody else's take away from anybody else's needs, but can also meet the needs of the Manomin and the local community. And in many cases, it's not that easy, and there are trade-offs and to be made around water decisions. But we think we need to really speak up and make sure that the needs of the community on the river are considered. The community that we're working with is located between two hydropower facilities, two dams, as Samantha mentioned. And so they're kind of at the mercy of the management of the choices that are made around operation of those facilities. I'm not seeing another question. Anybody else want to jump in while we have a chance? And if you think of something later, we're more than happy to respond by one of the other social media or email. So I'm not seeing another question. Brittany, do you have any thoughts you want to share before we wrap up?
Not that I can think of, other than it's an absolute joy to be here today and to talk Manomin. And if you haven't tried cooking with Manomin yet, I encourage you to visit your local grocer and pick some up and, experiment at home with these tastes so that you can begin building that relationship at home. So the sous chef has some recipes in his cookbook, which are delicious and easy to follow. You can also do a Google search for a Manomin cranberry salad. That's a common combination that's quite tasty. If you're a meat eater like I am, a Manomin bacon casserole, if you want to search for those keywords, I think is also just delicious. I think that's a really excellent first step in building a relationship with this plant.
Yeah. And Samantha, how about you? Do you have anything else you wanted to share before we wrap up for the day?
I think the last bit, and sometimes we do get this question because we are kind of such a unique interdisciplinary team. We've got Brittany from the Department of History, and then Andrea and I from engineering, but then also culturally a very intercultural team. And I really want to advocate for experiences like this. It's really tremendous getting to work with people who are coming from a completely different background, whether academic or cultural or whatnot. And when you go into it with open eyes and kind of an open heart and really just are excited about learning and seeing things in a different way, you can really learn a tremendous amount. So I feel very fortunate to be doing my PhD with these two wonderful women and with Nisechuan Anishinaabe Nation. So if you have an opportunity to go do some interdisciplinary work, I would definitely recommend.
Thank you for that, Samantha. That was very nice. So Brittany, I'll let you close off if you think we've reached the end. Brittany's supposed to give a sign, I think, to wrap up the session.
Oh yeah, I guess my sign will be thank you so much, everyone, for being here today. And I wish you all the best on your journey. So if you have any questions, we're available at Manomin Project on Instagram and Twitter, or at manominproject@gmail.com if you prefer to work by email. All right, take care, everybody. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, and thanks for joining.